interrupt and stop me so that we can take more questions from our members today. Welcome, ma'am, to this question answer. We'll try to keep it casual. We'll try to keep it informal and get to know more about you and your life. So the word IAS, I think, is the most sought after profession in India. Probably, like, you know, doctors, engineers, and IAS, they all come with the same breath when we're talking about sought after professions. So I would like to know what inspired you to choose the civil service as a profession? Was it your first choice? Was it your choice or was it your parents' choice? And also, tell us a little bit about your early childhood days in Uttar Pradesh.
Thank you. So, hi friends. Hi Sukirti, Chidatmika, all of you here. I've met some of you and some I'm meeting today. So it's great to be with all of you. But let me start with a disclaimer. I am really not this interview type of a person. So let's all keep it very, very informal. And I'm just chatting with you. So my inspiration actually is that if my own family, we are actually a family of bureaucrats. So my own father, uncles, everybody was in the business. So I actually liked what I saw. And so that desire, you know, it may sound a little cliched, but the desire was always there to do make a meaningful impact on society and all that. I thought that this was the best job. And so you won't believe this, but from class two, standard two, whenever we had to write an essay on my ambition or meri abhilasha or mera lakshya, I used to always write, it is to become an IAS officer. Since class two, imagine. And it's just God's grace that I made it. But that was totally a desire from the beginning. And it was just to make a meaningful impact and to also have the authority to do so. So that is why I like the IAS.
Thank you. Like we say, Tulasi Dui Patra Rubase, like from standard two, you were quite clear about where you want to be. So the IAS is supposed to be the toughest exam in the world. I mean, considering the number of aspirants who are appearing for the exams and the number of positions available. So, so how was it? Although you came from a family of bureaucrats, there's no nepotism in bureaucracy. Like I'm working in my father's business, but you would have to clear the exam to become an IAS. So how difficult was it? And did you clear in your first go? Or how difficult were your preparatory days?
Yeah. So of course, back, you're talking to an old lady, Tanaya. So it was 30 years back that I did all this preparation. But since I was so clear from the beginning, you know, I never thought of anything else, actually. So for me, it was just this. Everything it was geared towards joining this. I cleared it in the first attempt. But I always feel that there's a lot of luck element. Lot of people try, some make it, some don't. Doesn't mean that the others are not good enough or anything. But it was just my luck that I got in the first attempt. And I was 22, all of 22 at that time.
Thank you. So do you think, I mean, I wouldn't know, I'm asking you, is the civil service partial towards men, as we see in a lot? I'm talking about when you're working, in terms of your work experience. So you've been a collector also in Bargarh and in Sambalpur. So is it more difficult for a collector, sir, or a collector, madam?
Okay, so let me put it this way, that compared to maybe many other services, their discrimination in IAS is not there. So it's not that if you are a lady IAS officer, you will not get a particular district or you will not get a particular department. In fact, I'm heading, so while I'm heading WCD, I'm also heading what is technically called a Purus Mananka department, water resources, irrigation, because it's all engineering and all that. So that kind of discrimination by God's grace was not there. But as a lady collector, one did have issues in the district itself, because a lot of people used to, you know, when you come out of the car, there would be a logo, it's a lady, you know, or they would write the letter would be addressed to madam, and then a sir would also be written. So the madam wala sir. So collector was associated with male, and but I think they always liked it that a woman is there and she's doing so many things. That time there were fewer of us also, but now I think with more and more women coming in, that is also gone. In fact, we had an advantage. I always felt that as a woman, I had an advantage, because when I used to go into the field, into the villages, I would find that women would come out and talk. Otherwise, with male officers, perhaps, you know, they would be hiding. With us, I would often get into their houses, talk to their babies, pick up a baby, talk to the ladies. So they would overcome their shyness and all that and come forward, tell their problems. So that way, I never felt any difference.
Your husband is also an IS officer, Shri Saurabh. And so how do you think, do you think it's an advantage or a disadvantage? I mean, to IS officers, and you know what I'm asking, how is the chemistry, how's the dynamic, how do you manage to achieve some kind of a work-life balance?
Okay, so I think it depends on the maturity also. I mean, there can be problems and there can be no problems, as in normal other working couples. In the IAS, it's just good to have a colleague, your husband in the service, because they understand the demands of the job. So, and they also know that if you're a collector, you will be posted in a separate district. So they and then their naturally their families understand that this is how it is going to be. So they understand a lot more what are the compulsions of the job. They understand that you are going to be a lot more busy, and also it helps because you yourself also able to talk about so many things. Though me and my husband, we had made a pact initially when the kids were, that when we'll come back home, we will not talk about the job at all, so that the children don't get neglected, because we had so much to talk at all times. So that way it was very nice. We also had a pact that when the kids were small, I said that, look, I will have to go back because the children need me a lot more at this stage. But at any point, if I cannot go, let's say by 6:30 or something, then that day you have to make an effort and go back so that somebody, one of us at least, should be there. So that really worked, because most of the times I would try to go at 6:30. But if I couldn't, supposing a meeting comes up at 7:30 or something like that, then he would certainly go. And also the, you know, work-life balance is like all of you are working, so you all also go through the same. That work-life balance is so difficult when the kids are smaller. But I always made it a point when my kids were smaller that 6:30 and no more. So the moment I would be, it would be 6:30, I would pick up my handbag and walk out of the door. But I had to carry files back, especially when I had. So I would then put my child to sleep. At 10 to 2, I would do my files. And you know, children, Murphy's Law, that when you don't want them to sleep, they will never sleep. And so those things happen. But I think that happens with all of us working women. I'm sure we all go through the same things. But otherwise, no problem. I mean, yes, a lot of people do try to, you know, also put you against each other also, that he's good, better, she's better and all that. But that, I think we were both far too mature to get into that rat race.
Yes, you call this a power couple. And I think that's given a lot of confidence to us who are trying to juggle work and personal life. Yes. I think this pack thing can be explored. I think I'll explore this with my husband. Maybe it might be a success. Yes. So talking about women, you are deeply involved with Mission Shakti. I think Mission Shakti has been a revolutionary initiative of the government of Odisha. So now you are an inspiration to many. That's why we have you here today at our inspiration series. But you know, the women leading the SHGs, they have been like completely, completely amazing. Like we have one of them also representing us in the parliament. Yes. So I would like to know How do you get inspired by them? Although you're from, you know, two completely different leagues, but still you work so closely together. So what inspires you? How do they inspire you?
Oh, tremendously. Much like you inspire me, all of you. You know, you people must be thinking for that, oh, IAS or a doctor. But for us, entrepreneur, I find that the most difficult thing to do. I mean, to pick up a business and to run it on your own is, for me, very, very inspiring, just like a self-help group. You see, for me, what is very inspiring from the beginning that how a rural lady, you know, with so many other commitments of the house and obligations and all that, is able to branch out and take on something, and that too with so many other ladies, have a certain sense of discipline in a self-help group, and then be able to actually get profit and work on it, and without a formal education. Deeply inspiring. Some stories, if I tell you all, there are women's groups which are actually, you know, running, they are doing our meter reading, let's say. They are doing meter reading for us. They are running bills. They are running my take-home ration, what we prepare, that chatua. They are doing that. And it's, and everything entails keeping the books. It entails procurement of goods. It entails interpersonal relations. So I think in ease, they are becoming better and better and better. And now they all have huge turnovers, some of them not doing so well also, but a range of activities are being done by them. For example, in Orissa, we have also given our Gram Panchayat tanks to them, the water tanks in villages, which was earlier being given to different people. Now they are doing it for pisciculture, and they are taking the fish and selling it. So small businesses, it's like women entrepreneurs, like all of you, but at a little smaller level, but deeply inspired.
So talking about Mission Shakti again, which has been a big success story. So Mission Shakti has at its helm of affairs two female bureaucrats, yourself and Shrimati Sujata Karthikeyan, who again is an achiever, a go-getter. So now there is this conception or misconception that women can't work well together. So you tell us about working with Mrs. Karthikeyan, and you know, how has your chemistry been, and is it really true that, you know, women don't get along well with each other?
Rubbish. I think women get along. See, the whole self-help group movement is based on women being together, right? So it's a group of 10, 12 women who are together. We have 6 lakh such groups. So where is this thing that women can't get along with each other? I mean, that's rubbish. Sujata is a dear friend of mine from long back, long we were working. And I'm so happy now Mission Shakti has in fact been declared as a separate department. And now Sujata is a secretary. So I was telling her, now she is independently the secretary of the department, and she's doing an outstanding job. So there is absolutely this thing that women can't work. I've had so many women bosses and had best of relationships, had male bosses, maybe not the best of relationships. So you can't, all that is rubbish.
I think some people would like to believe that women can't work together, because if women get together, then they can be really powerful. They can create magic.
Yes.
We are like 101 of us together in this group.
Yes.
So,
yes. So tell me, does anybody feel that? No, not at all. You know, that is long back. People must have made these things when there were very few women. Now there are so many women everywhere, and everybody has, I think that's old-fashioned and not true at all.
So for our previous inspiration series, we had invited Shrimati Aparajita Sarangi, where we had a talk with her. And she's a great example of a bureaucrat turned politician who took public service to another level. She won the elections. She's really, really popular. So what about you? Do you have any plans of joining politics? Because that is also a platform to do something for the people which you've always wanted. So what are your thoughts about that? And which of the two, politics or civil service, do you think is a better platform to serve the people?
Both are lovely platforms. Both are lovely platforms where you can really, I mean, if you have the desire to make a difference, you can make a difference. Both are lovely, but it depends on your own personal choice. So at present, I'm very, very happy in my job as a bureaucrat. I'm sure Aprajita has moved ahead and she's very happy there. So it depends on what is your personal nature like, but both are absolutely outstanding ways of being able to make a difference.
Ma'am, you have a degree in sociology, and I think you have a double master's. You took a break and you
was in public health.
In public health. So could you tell us something about getting back to studying after the break, and how the experience was and how it has helped you further your career, or how important it is to keep learning, irrespective of age?
Yeah, true. So as I told you, I had joined at 22. So I had just, in fact, my master's result had not come out. My master's in sociology, the result came after the IAS result. When I reached the academy, I was among the rookies, the others were far more experienced. They had, some of them had work experience, some of them had a management degree plus a doctorate and things like that. So once I got an opportunity, I thought I'd as well do a master's, a double master's. So, and since I was in Ministry of Health and I loved the subject, I thought, let me do it in public health. And I did it from Johns Hopkins University, Bloomberg School of Public Health. And that time it was considered one of the very good schools of public health. Mm-hmm. And I went in with 15 years of service. So the thing is that I was amongst the oldies in my class and with the most experience. So it was, for me, it was an eye-opening experience. I loved every bit of it. And so get back to the rigors of reading and then doing exams, submitting papers, and in class also, interacting with the youngsters, getting again a little more familiar with technology compared to the youngsters. I was quite, so all those things I thought really helped me. And when I came back with a degree in public health, a lot of people told me that typical bureaucrat, bureaucracy, once you have a degree in something, they will never post you in that department. So that is so. But surprisingly for me, I was immediately posted as Secretary of Health in Government of Orissa, and was allowed to work for 4 years. And so it was, I was able to use whatever I had learned, so make it a little more professional. And because I had come with a degree, so my acceptance with the doctors with whom I had to interact a lot as a Secretary of Health was also, so they couldn't say, oh, a generalist has come and is sitting on top of us. They now knew that I also had a little bit of a background. And so that way I had a better acceptance, let me put it this way.
I think, in fact, for a very long time, you've been posted with the Department of Health and Family Welfare in different positions. You worked with the PMO as well in the center, in the state. So, madam, for a country like India, like, despite so many policies, despite, so many efforts for past so many years, we're still struggling with malnutrition when it comes to children. We still, maternity health, the importance that should be given to women when it comes to their health. So why do you think, we're still in such a sad space after so many years?
So let me make it a little more optimistic than you are making it to be. The fact is that there has been a lot of improvement. If you see what we have here, from year to year, there is a lot of improvement. So maternal mortality, for example, or infant mortality, or neonatal mortality, in all that, India is improving. Odisha is also improving. And in fact, the improvements are now, you know, the rate of improvement is accelerated. So I won't say that, you know, nothing, not so bleak. Things are improving, and things like malnutrition and all are not things which you can change overnight. These are things which, because this involves behavioral change, it is not that I can make a building and or a road or a bridge and so everything is done. You, it's a behavioral change that has to come. So education of the person, the various superstitions, all those things the person has to be brought out of. So social sector is that way always so much more challenging. It's not like an infrastructure sector where you just make and you're done. Here you may make an Anganwadi center, but if the people are not convinced, the children will not come. If the children are not, mothers are not convinced, the children will not eat. They will not improve. So it is, it's a slower process. It takes a lot more time. But the good thing is that changes are taking place and things are improving.
Ma'am, what would your suggestion and your advice be for us women entrepreneurs who are a part of this committee? How can we motivate more and more women to join the workforce? And how can we make the our workplaces happier and safer places for women?
So nice. So I think just by being yourself an entrepreneur and holding this position that you all are holding, you're already inspiring so many people. You know, whenever I used to go to, as a young collector or a sub-collector, all of 24, 25, I used to go to these women's colleges and so for some annual day or chief guest and this and that. I still remember how the girls would look. That is still imprinted in my mind because there was that look of admiration that one day I will also be. And so I feel that, you know, some of us, by just being ourselves, just having taken on a certain role and being able to do it nicely, we become role models. I mean, much as you don't want to be or you feel, I in fact feel very awkward about all this. But the fact is that the little girls do get inspired. So A, by just being there and doing what you all are doing is good enough. But apart from that, I believe you all have sessions. So keep having your sessions where you explain your things to them, that these are the difficulties. Most women don't come out because sometimes they just don't know what is available. The enabling environment or what the IPR has in for them or what the startup policy has for them or whatever are the other things which are favoring women, let's say. They must know about all that. They may need a little bit of financial literacy. Most women would like something like that. And if as a group, you all can work with, you can identify potential entrepreneurs, bring them and kind of motivate them, build their confidence, teach them on some financial literacy and also practical tips. These are things where you will face challenges. These are things where you can take advantages. Then I think we can work together and you can also put them in touch. So the kind of networking amongst them with all of you, that could also be very useful.
Ma'am, like you said, enabling women to come into business, to succeed in business and, you know, hand-holding them. These are some of the core objectives of the IWEC. And I think Sukirti and Chidatmika are working towards it. And with your support, I think I'm sure we would be able to conduct more sessions and, you know, make an impact. One more thing I wanted to ask you is, when you began your career, there was no social media. So today grievances come as notifications in the form of tweets, Facebook posts. So it brings credibility and good public relations. However, there's also pressure to maintain an image in the digital world. So I'm sure there are many IAS officers who are doing stellar work, but do not have the time or inclination to post about it online. So as someone who's been part of both the worlds, you know, pre-social media, post-social media, what do you think are the advantages and disadvantages? And, you know, how do you deal with this whole pressure of being active on social media.
You're sounding like my daughter. Okay. So, so yes, I am totally, you know, the social media, so many advantages. These days, the biggest advantage is you can just get to so many people at the same time. You can get not just the complaint, you can even get a what is going wrong. So these are things which in our time we never had. For example, the kind of complaints we would get are that the person couldn't write themselves, right? So they would go to a scribe and that scribe would write or get it typed. And in the end, they would write, and for this, we shall ever pray. You know, that type of thing where from the heart, the person is not able to even complain. Now we are getting videos of what is going wrong. People are emailing, social media, so I think that is a very, very big advantage. The disadvantage, of course, is that very often it becomes too omnipresent and a little too much to handle. But I would still feel that its advantages far, far, far outweigh, if any, disadvantages.
Ma'am, what's the first thing you do when you wake up in the morning? A lot of us go for our phones and social media.
So I've become almost as bad as the youngsters. I also reach out for my phone and I look at social media, yes. So I've become as bad as all of you.
Ma'am, I want to ask you, you were involved in the cyclone preparations as well. Yes. And in fact, just a couple of months ago, I was thinking how difficult it would be to actually manage a cyclone and the COVID pandemic together. And it actually happened. And it's past us now. There were no casualties. We, as usual, have aced the art of disaster management. But could you share us some insight about how this COVID cyclone war room was, when you're evacuating people? You're saving their lives, but also they are made to be together in a cyclone shelter where social distancing is just not possible. So could you tell us something about what your approach was, and do you feel happy when we get accolades or we get praised for our preparedness and our work in this area? Or as in the government, Odisha?
No, yours also, the entire state feels happy. I feel very happy. And in fact, see, this is one of the joys of my job. The job satisfaction that I get is immense. If you are able to handle a cyclone of that magnitude without any casualty, it is so satisfying for all of us who were working as a team. The war room, when we all started the preparations, each day we were reviewing, okay, now it's going to turn this way or that way. So we were also becoming almost as technical as the meteorological department and wishing that it would somehow bypass us, but alas. And then our preparation started, even let's say from water resources department, which is the other department I hold, we had to ensure that wherever we had reservoirs, if there is water in them, we had to take out that water so that when the cyclone comes and there is too much rainfall, at that time then we don't need to take water because there would be enough water in the rivers in any case. So that kind of preparation where each tank, each water reservoir was checked whether the water level is enough, just enough. And everywhere where there were vulnerable points, those were checked. And then all men, people were posted, senior officials were deputed so that they can take decisions on the spot. You are right, with COVID, our challenge was double. Because if let's say we were using 4,000 shelters, now we used 8,000 shelters because we tried to space out the people. If we were, let's say, taking 4,000 vehicles to evacuate the people, this time we took 8,000 vehicles to evacuate the people. So, and in each place, we gave masks, we gave sanitizers, we gave training to the people that this is how it has to be done. And so it was a huge challenge. In fact, we also do one more thing is that during cyclones, we always carry the pregnant ladies, not to the cyclone shelters, we take them straight to the hospital. All those who were due for delivery, let's say by the 1st of June, we had taken all of them to the, we listed them out. There were some 4,000 such ladies. Out of that 2,000 whose dates were really close were taken to the hospitals, parked there, again with all possible precautions because we were very, very careful for them. And out of that, you'll be so happy to know that almost 800 had babies.
We saw some lovely pictures also.
Yeah, and so it is, it's you, and you may have read some stories where if they, many of them said that if we hadn't gone to the hospital, we have been marooned in our village and we couldn't have, and had it been a complicated delivery, things would have gone wrong. So these were the kind of challenges that we had, very difficult with COVID. Also, sometimes, you know, these are things where You yourself also feel very apprehensive. The people were also apprehensive, but then it was done. And now we are getting everybody tested and all that. We are hoping that things will be okay.
Ma'am, the way you've described the challenges, if we were in another time, it sounds like some difficult video game challenge where you have to, you know, evacuate people also, you have to maintain distancing also. But, you know, I'm glad we're past that. We're coming to an end. So I'm going to ask some very short, fun questions.
Okay.
So you're from Lucknow, and Lucknow is famous for, you know, food, galotti kebabs and tinde kebabs. So are you a foodie? What do you like to eat? And do you cook?
I'm a foodie, but I cook. I'm a foodie, but I'm a vegetarian. So no kebabs for me.
So yeah,
very, very disappointing. But I do cook. I have two growing children. So I have to come back and cook sometimes Italian or Mexican or Thai. So I do cook. Yes, I love it.
What about books? What are the books that have had an influence in you, or what would be the books that you, or books or movies which you would recommend?
Okay. So I read all kinds of books, but movies I've not seen too many of late. I do see a few serials. I see your shows, a lot of shows. So I have been seeing this show called, I only see these type of white collar. So something to completely take my mind off my work. So every day, 1 hour, I see a show.
So that's your Netflix and chill time.
Yes, my chill time. And also my family time, because that is the time we all four of us sit down together and we see one show, 1 hour, one episode a day. We're very disciplined about that.
Ma'am, what about when we talk about the third wave, the scare that, you know, children are going to be affected comes with it. So how prepared do you think we are as a state to manage the third wave, and are we doing enough?
Yeah. Okay. So the disclaimer is that experts are saying, I mean, there is no evidence to say that it will be affecting children. But the assumption is that since by then, either the adults and the oldies would be affected or vaccinated, so the children would be a little more vulnerable. But our preparations are on. So number one, the state has made a technical committee. There is a pediatric task force which is looking into all these aspects of whether we have all the infrastructure. Now, pediatric ICUs would be required, pediatric ventilators would be required, consumables, medicines, etc. would be required. So this group is seeing what all is already there and what more would need to be there and what else therefore to be procured, and to start the process of procurement as well. Apart from that, what we are doing is, I'm also, by the way, heading a capacity building vertical in our COVID management team. So I am actually getting all the trainings done. So every day we are having training webinars for doctors. We are training Anganwadi workers. We are training Ayush doctors, pharmacists, nurses, refreshing them on the new guidelines which come. That also, what we are doing is that we are going to sensitize all the pediatricians about the latest protocols and whatever are the SOPs. But because we don't have so many pediatricians, what we'll do is that in each of the PHCs and the CHCs at the rural level, the primary health centers, we will also be training one general doctor and a general nurse on how to handle COVID in children. So that training we are going to do. We are also creating a lot of IEC material videos, which we can post on social media and Doordarshan and other things, so that parents whose children get affected will also be able to know how to handle the child in home isolation, how to handle the child in, let's say, in a hospital. Apart from that, we've also given guidelines, the health department, on how to handle to the doctors, how to handle children, etc. So the preparation is going on, and we are hoping, first of all, we are hoping that the third wave does not come. One is so tired of second wave, and so keeping fingers crossed. But should it come, the state is gearing up to meet the challenge.
Thank you. That was quite reassuring, and these are some concrete steps that you've planned. So you've been an observer also for COVID in Bhubaneswar. So the pandemic has resulted in an atmosphere of complete chaos. There's despair, there's gloom everywhere. I know you being at the helm of affairs, you must be having to deal with all this every day. So how do you deal with it, and how do you take care of your mental health? Because, you know, even us sitting at home, listening and watching the news, it just gets so depressing.
Yes,
you must be having to actually, you know, deal with it on ground. So how do you take care of yourself?
See, it is very depressing, and there is no doubt about it. And if you start seeing the television and the news, then you're doomed. So I don't see too much TV. I don't see too much news. I see what has to be seen. But then, but you're right. I mean, I have been flooded with phone calls asking for help, and not just as COVID observer, but also as head of the two departments where my own officers, their families, their staff's families sometimes needed ICU or some medicine or a hospital or needed to be shifted and things like that. So it is, it was very traumatic. But you know, for us, it is duty, and at that time, think of nothing else, but how to immediately try to help that person in the best possible manner. And when that person gets well and comes out and thanks you, I think that is how everything is forgotten. But more importantly, I think this is a general rule which I follow, that office is office. And then when you come back, you have to keep smiling as much as you can, and keep your spirits high, because if you yourself fall, then, you know, so I try to do that for myself, for my children, for my mental health, as you like to call it.
Thank you, ma'am. I had a great time talking to you. I think your answers were really crisp and short, so we could take more questions.
Yeah.
And I hope this was not an interview type thing. And
No. It was great fun. It was great.
Ma'am, we have some questions from our members. So sure. If you would give us a little bit more time, I will be asking them to ask you their questions.
Sure.
The first question is by Ms. Subhashri Banja, member of the Women's Entrepreneurship Committee. Subhashri, can you please ask your question?
Good evening, ma'am. It's very exciting to know about your journey so far. My question is for you. Though there is national policy for empowerment of women in 2001, still we have not achieved as like other developing countries. Dear ma'am, what measures to be taken for women empowerment? Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. So, see what for women's empowerment, there are so many aspects of women empowerment. Economic empowerment is one, and this is a very critical one. Women entrepreneurship is, that's how you all are empowered. I am empowered. And by this Mission Shakti is one way of empowering women. So the self-help group movement in the state has been one policy initiative to economically empower the women. The second is social empowerment. So, and the third is political empowerment. Political empowerment, you know, our chief minister has always been a very vocal about how many, what percentage of, so we have 50% reservation in the Panchayati Raj institutions. And you won't believe it, but our actual number is more than 50%. Women. So it's 53. That means even more than that, women are coming and are accepted. So political, that is political empowerment. MPs are women, MLAs, women, ministers, women. So that is there. And social empowerment, that is one place where we have to work a little bit more, but we are like, for example, we have this huge drive against child marriage now. We are trying to stop as many child marriages as possible, going against domestic violence. So those are also things in the pipeline. But I believe that with education, with economic empowerment, work on social empowerment, I'm sure we are going to get there very soon.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Thank you. The next question is by Soni Saman, also a member of our committee. Soni, sure. Please go ahead.
Ma'am, good evening.
Good evening.
And ma'am, it's an absolute awe experience hearing you. I met you for the first time in Make in Odisha Conclave. Yes. I felt the energy and the energy of the entire SHG group. I had a few minutes to speak to you and got those vibes since then, ma'am. Sure. When Sukirti told me, Soni, why don't you interact with her? And I'm like, there's so much of things to learn, and it never felt like I'm talking to an ICE officer. It felt I'm talking to my mentor, my guide who understands my problem, the problem of my people. And thank you for being so much approachable, ma'am. Ma'am, I lead a very focused marketing and communications and business. And I understand the power of communication, the power of clarity, which you have been greatly emphasizing, ma'am. What I've realized over a period of time, there are a lot of policies, welfare schemes, a lot of benefits which are there for entrepreneurs, especially women entrepreneurs. So my request or suggestions or a kind of, your inputs would be, could we have one platform which holds information so that we don't have to run from pillar to post? If I'm into this business, where do I check? What benefits do I get? Who do I meet? So just wanted your input. So that's because you have been strongly emphasizing on one-stop solutions, focus, clarity. Could there be one platform that would be a great benefit for all of us? Your suggestions, please.
Yeah. No, thanks. That's a lovely idea. I will discuss this with industry. On their website, they should have special provisions for women entrepreneurs, and maybe list out all those things there. I'll do that. We'll get it done for you. But I am really one with you when you say that we need to have a huge communication drive, even for my schemes, like we have so many schemes for women. And then it really beats me when you go and then people say, Ame to janinu, or I have actually come up with a department mascot. So there is this lady called Tikki Mousi. We made one oldish, not oldish, like my age, so not really old, lady who wears a Sambalpuri sari and, typical Oriya sari with that thing which we put here and Bhauja type of look. and she is the woman of the village, for the village, by the village, and she knows more than the villagers. People respect her. So through her, now we are trying to get a lot of messages. So for example, we've shot a lot of videos, animated where, you know, she says, "Are Hariya, tu to, why you are not taking your wife for this?" And so he says, "Nahi, why should I do it, Tikki Mausi?" And then she says, "Are emti kariba katha, semti kariba katha." And in a nice, fun manner, she is doing. So we are trying to use Tikki Mausi as a mascot of the department to reach out in a rural type of interesting manner, to reach out to the people about all the things that I was saying, because social sector means I need to change behaviors. I yes. want them to, if I want that, you don't send a child marriage should not be done. So I can't just say, you know, no, you don't. I have to tell them that, look, this is a penal, there is a penal provision. You can be taken to jail. So and so can complain, and why you should not do it. And the mother should know, the father should know, the girl should know. So I really have to reach out with my messages to everybody. And the sarpanch must know, so that if there is a marriage taking place, he is able to inform. So that I am 100% with you that there is a great need for communication and to...
Thank you, Sony. Thank you, Sony, for that excellent suggestion. And ma'am, your Odia is super cute. It's really good to see, you know, all the officers who actually speak very, very good Odia, a lot of IAS officers. So it's heartwarming to see that. Our next question is...
Also.
Sorry, ma'am?
I said I make a lot of mistakes and so my people laugh behind my back.
That's all right. We learn only when we make mistakes. So Miss Amrina Ali, she's also a member of IWC. She's going to ask you the next question.
I think I've met her.
Yeah, ma'am.
You came to her
office. We have met. I've come with Chida, ma'am, to your
place. Labor, ma'am.
Yeah, yeah. Gigi, ma'am.
Okay.
That
okay.
You remember me? That's,
of course, I remember. You have that store.
Health mall, ma'am.
Health mall. You had
told yes, ma'am. So it was a very nice meeting and I was liking the interaction going on. Very, very nice suggestions. Ma'am, I just have a very simple question. Like in a day of an entrepreneur, every day is not the same. We have our own highs, we have our lows. Some days are very energetic. Another, next day we want to just close everything and shut. So we have a shell where we go into. So do you also have these kind of mood swing and phases? And if so, how? What is the driving force which brings you back with loads of energy the next morning?
Oh, yes, in many, many, many. I always sing the song, Zindagi Har Ghadi Ek Nayi Jangal.
Definitely, ma'am.
So, see, for me, for us in the service, there are so many things where you can get dampeners. You are doing your best, but you open the morning paper and they will take out something really nasty about the department. And all that. So it tends to dampen your spirits. I even know of senior officers, you know, who start crying because very often it can become personal or court cases, you know, for something which was done 20 years back. I am suddenly hauled up for personal appearance. So that is again a dampener. And we get these dampeners every day, day after day, hour after hour. But so the thing, the beauty is, don't let it bother you. Okay, yes. It has come, address it. So we become a lot more thick-skinned. You realize there will be ups and downs. So if the media is writing good about you, the media will write bad about you also. It's okay, no problem. And so that's how one copes. I'm sure, like you all are, we also cope. We go ahead in life.
Yeah, thank you so much, ma'am. Thanks for inspiring.
Thank you, Amrina Didi. We have Kavita Gupta who's going to be asking
a question.
Yeah, hi. Good evening, ma'am. Namaste.
Namaste.
So it's really nice, quite inspiring listening to you, ma'am. Ma'am, I have a small question. As my individual passion, I got an opportunity to meet the underprivileged children and destitute women. I visit to mental asylum. I go to slum areas to teach meditation and mind power activities to underprivileged children, because being my passion, I teach meditation and I'm a spiritual coach. I have written a book also for teenagers about moral values. Okay. Because what I feel this is most important, to give the moral education to our youth, which is missing, which is not there in our academics. So what I feel, ma'am, when I meet these ladies or children, most of the times the violence against their own relatives, and their rights are, you know, they grab their rights. Like for an example, I'll say I lost my driver because of this COVID 1 month back. And today his sister called up saying that their maternal uncle, he's trying to grab the entire money. And because they are illiterate, they don't know. So whom to complain? Because it's the violence is by their own relative. So how we can do, what kind of change we can bring, and how we can help these kind of women and children? Because in mental asylum also, when I go and spend time with them, it's really, really very touchy. Because when we talk to them, they say, like, you know, one lady, she said, ma'am, I'm perfectly fine. I'm quite educated. It's only because of selfish ends of my bhai and bhabhi, they put me in this mental asylum. I'm not mad. And I was really into tears listening to her story. So, ma'am, as two things, like as an individual, because I feel I can bring some change. Can we really do something together to bring this meditation or these kind of spiritual knowledge among those victims? And how can we be part of it? If I would like to volunteer, or maybe my team or more people, if they would like to volunteer. So as an entrepreneur also, or, and how we can, and then one more thing, not only these, the widows of soldiers, I feel, because there's no consistent checkup, no follow-up. It's just one-time financial support, government and people, they do and give. Then we make them heroes. And it's just one-time financial support. But after that, did they really get the financial help, their children, their widow? And all the money is taken back by the relatives. So that's really sad, ma'am. So what best we can do to help them, actually?
Yeah. No, Kavita, it's very nice that you are volunteering and you are going to these places. Actually, we need that. We need, you see, government, as I said, can set up institutions, but government cannot get into families and tell uncle and auntie not to behave in a particular manner. So, but people can, like you, people, NGOs, community, that kind of pressure can be put by them, and support, like legal support. Supposing the girl you are saying who has been forced, she can maybe take some legal recourse, I don't know. But for that, there are support systems. So there is a legal aid society where she can be helped with some legal aid. But basically what such people require are people like you, who should take up take up cudgels on her behalf and try to resolve issues, talk to her parents or people who will be able to support her against her brother and bhabhi. And I think you can also, the State Commission for Women also takes up some of these type of cases, where you know, they can call both sides and talk it out and discuss things with them and see that something can be done. But there is every space for civil society and committed individuals like you to come in and to help. Because this is some place where government cannot go into families and do. So thank you. Thank you for doing the good work.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Kavita. Sukirti, our convener, she's going to ask her question.
Yeah, thank you, Tanaya. Thank you, ma'am. It's an absolute, absolute pleasure. And I mean, your smile actually made my day. I think all our days. So I must tell you that, you know, each and every member is an absolute champion for women empowerment in our group, right? We have seen it during the COVID times. You won't believe, like, one message and 10 people are running to help that person, to arrange for beds, to give medicines, you know, to anything and everything. And, you know, like, it has been amazing experience. So, but for the entire state to grow, we need to take this entrepreneurship drive to the rural areas as well, right? So, and in one of the events that we have planned in the future, we together want to make a difference to the rural scenery and, you know, like, help women or maybe encourage women, inspire women to, you know, do something on their own, live their passion. So, ma'am, I would like to ask this question as to how IWEC can collaborate with Mission Shakti going forward so that we can also do our bit, you know, for the society. And maybe we also learn in that manner and grow together. Thank you.
Oh, that's very nice. I'm sure Mission Shakti would love to collaborate with see, Mission Shakti takes up training programs of its self-help groups. Okay. I think one role which you all can play, a very positive role, is being a resource person in those trainings, because you are actually in the field, you are running a business, right? So if they find that somebody has come with actual experience of running a business, you will be able to tell them, talk to them, enthuse them. So they have these training programs. They also have financial literacy programs. Then you can guide them on marketing of their products. Maybe some of you, if your business is like that, I don't know, depends on the base business. But supposing you feel that something which they are producing is of interest.
Right,
then,
right.
Then would you like to kind of help them in marketing that? That is our weakest link. Mm-hmm. So there are several ways in which it can be done, and I can talk to Sujata and put you in touch with some of these groups which are there.
That would be lovely, ma'am. We have chartered accountants, we have marketing wizards, Sodhi is here, we have Shama, and then we have from every sphere you can talk about, we have women entrepreneurs from there, from grocery to restaurants to salons to hospitals, finance, everything. So, ma'am, yes, we would love the opportunity to serve the state and, you know, collaborate. So please do kindly let us. Thank
will
you.
Will do. And if you all feel, it's again up to you, but we have started this drive to because my orphanages in the Women and Child Development Department, we have 2 orphanages. So we are trying to give them laptops, because these days it's all online. Mm-hmm. And so in case as a body, you people feel that you would like to contribute to that, then I can also put you in touch with the person so that you don't have to make it very big, and maybe even just one orphanage, if you can cover with, let's say, 5 or 10 laptops, then all of them can do their studies. So that is also something you can consider.
That's a lovely initiative, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you, Sukirti. The last question is by our co-convener, Ms. Chidatmika Khatwa. Chida, please go ahead.
Yeah, good afternoon. It's lovely, madam. I'm just mesmerized by your smile and talk and everything I can say. In fact, I would like to share also to my close friends here who are connected today through IWEC. I know Anu ma'am since she was the collector of Bargad. And I'll tell you that flyer today, what we have made is intelligent, focused, and determined. The three things is the right profit for her, no doubt about it. And she take very fast decision. And that time, let me tell you, Tanaya, when you asked about the malnutrition, the iron deficiency anemia and iron deficiency disorder, that time I was connected for that similar project with madam. I was working for a project of Government of India of iron deficiency anemia and iodine deficiency, and she's so fast decision. And I have seen that she is a lady of bold and beautiful, I can say. that the thing. And a few things also.
You didn't say bold and beautiful.
Yeah, ma'am. Yeah, ma'am. You are. You are. And sure, this is so first decision to Texas. And that time I was newly just settling between Delhi and Bhubaneswar. I was saying, who is this Wonder Woman? Takes so fast decision, because I have seen that the IAS officer files niche se upar move karega, fir aap signature karoge, fir iske piche padho, and you take just rightly straight at yes. This things has to be done. So that the thing, you purchase my heart from that moment only. It was so smart. And, you know, recently also, guys, I just wanted to share with you a few days back, I called to madam because of my hospital, some issue of the, because we are treating the COVID patient. So some medicine issue again. And I also, madam, I'm not getting, and she all of a sudden, and again, BMC immediately after 1 hour, they called me that, okay, you need this, and we are. So she is a solution person, always I've seen a power woman. And ma'am, today I have no question because you already, you know, answered everything. Few suggestions I'll give you, ma'am. As security told that we have a full force of power women are in one basket. So we are planning in future for a business mela and targeting definitely of like, you know, women from rural and urban around 500 to 1,000. I think Mission Shakti is collaborating with us that mission and vision can be success. I also request another thing, that lovely video which you have shown just after deliberation of our convener security, if that can be placed in Mission Shakti website, that will be really inspiring for us. Because we women are bahut pyar se banaye usko. Last time when COVID started, we did that. And today, actually, in officially, you launched that video in this webinar. And this lovely suggestion you are given that we women can mentor this SAGs ladies, because all expertise, even women together can do the magic, which you say. It's not conflict. Women can do the magic together. So this is the three appeal I request you, ma'am, on behalf of IWEC.
Sure.
Thank you.
Sure.
Thank you, Shidatmika. From my side, I am really, really grateful to Anu, ma'am, for answering all my questions. I had a really, really good time conversing with you, and I'm sure so did everyone who joined in. So I'm signing off from my side. Shidatmika would request you to do the formal vote of thanks.
Thank you, Tanaya. In fact, we have come to today end of the very beautiful session, very inspiring, lots of intakes. The four-year child went determined to be ICE officer. Just amazing, I will say that we didn't know that time that what is ICE officer is, and you dreamed to be ICE officer. That is hands off. You are a really true minister, woman of substance, ma'am. And I'm privileged. You accepted, I think all women fraternity today is you know, grateful to you, ma'am. You accepted our invitation in spite of your busy schedule. And I know that your COVID flood, for that we have to reschedule also that when you called up. But really grateful, ma'am, today you even share your valuable timing for IWEC women. It is really inspiring. And today, takeaway, ladies, from Madam's life, I'll say she's a woman who knows how to balance the life for a woman as a mother, as a IAS officer, even a public servant. She has to take care of, which we learned that today she's so nicely managing her timing and determined, so that today she's a superwoman and having the power couple also. And today I'll say few words like, our assumption that life is generous, we can control the disasters, but God is very benevolent. And that good people are spread from suffering from crashing down. In those moments, we need to understand that despite of being heroine, all these feelings are normal and appropriate. Life, we can muster the courage to face them. And facing the loss with courage helps you to heal. So friends, remember that when you risk the death, then life available. With these lines, this is Chidatmika on behalf of entire IWEC fraternity, thanks to our chair, Mr. J.B. Pani, co-chair, Mr. M.K. Gupta, our beautiful convener, Sukriti Patnaik, and our moderator of today, the Tanaya Patnaik, the entire beautiful, lovely participants who have very actively participated and understood and take away from our lovely ma'am, Anu ma'am. And thank you very much, ma'am. We wanted that your inspiration, your guidance, and you'll be a lead candle light for us, lots of women entrepreneurs years ahead. As a woman, we salute you from our core of heart. Jai Jagannath, thank you very much. This is Chidatmika signing off.
Thank you. Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you,
thank
ma'am.
You, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you.
Bye, everyone.
Lovely meeting you.
Same here, ma'am.
Thank you. Bye. Thank you, ma'am. Bye.
Thank you. Bye. Bye.
Bye, ma'am.